that this is God's contact. It's the umbilical cord, if you please, between God, heaven, the central heaven, and this lost planet. Now, of all the experiences I've had, the most thrilling, I was holding a meeting over in North Carolina one afternoon. I'd shown the videos of all the discoveries, and I was giving people an opportunity to ask questions. Well, somebody said, "Ron, do you camp out when you go on these digs?" And I said, "No, I stay in a cheap hotel, the Jerusalem Hotel." I said, "I got all the camping out and more than I wanted when I was in the Army." And I don't know, people that hadn't had that experience, some folks like camping, but I guarantee you I don't. Don't bother inviting me to go camping with you. It's not something I do. Unless, of course, when the Sunday law is passed and they're about to trying to kill us or something, I might be motivated, you know, to do that. But anyway, somebody else said, "Well, when are you going back?" And I said, "Around the middle of September." Well, what I didn't know, there was a doctor out there in the audience. And, of course, doctors, a lot of them have a fair amount of money. And he didn't bother to ask me, but when my day crew and I showed up at the Jerusalem Hotel on the 15th of September that year, he was sitting on the top of the steps. Well, all of a sudden, my whole world crashed, folks, because I knew I couldn't work on the Ark of the Covenant with that guy there, because he hadn't asked if it was all right. And godly people ask. They don't just pop up like that. And so I thought, well, some of my mistakes, and they're considerable, has cut me off from God. He can't use me anymore in this work. So I just said, "Lord, I'm sorry, whatever it was. If I can help whoever you want to finish this, I'll be delighted." So anyway, we did some landscaping in the garden tomb. They had collected years of junk and debris in there, and we hauled off, I think it was like 15 truck, big dump truck loads of trash out of the back of the garden out there. And so anyway, we had a fan. It was real hot that year, and this fan was moving enough air to make it livable, and then the thing sputtered and sparked and quit. Well, that was kind of like Job's gourd vine. I'm not Job's, but Jonah, thank you. Jonah's gourd vine to me. When that went, you know, the last drops of my courage went along with it, and I was sitting there feeling hopeless. I figure if you blow something that important, that not only are you out of a job, but you're lost. And I was extremely depressed. And I heard a voice, a very kind voice, say, "God bless you and what you're doing here." Have you ever had somebody say, call your name and say, "What are you doing?" And you knew that they knew what you were doing, like your mother or your dad once, or who did this, and you know they know who did it. Well, I knew that whoever that voice belonged to knew more than I had told anybody, because I don't tell everybody everything I'm doing and where and all of this. You can't nowadays. So anyway, I looked up startled to see who this was. And folks, it was the being whose crucifixion site I had found in whose blood I had found on the mercy seat. And I sat there stunned. I don't know how long. This doctor, when the pan quit, he... Did you all walk out to the top of that little sidewalk that goes towards the chapel? Did you all walk out there where you turn left and go down to the lower level? I was sitting flat on the ground in front of that chapel. He was standing at the end of that sidewalk up above me there. I got a real good look at him. But the doctor didn't. He was back, had scooted back under the bushes to get some shade and was eating his lunch. Well, when I kind of got over my shock, I wanted to make sure it was Christ. You remember Thomas? He wanted to put his fingers in his wounds. I didn't think of that, or I'd probably ask for that. But anyway, I said, "Do you live around here, sir?" He said, "No." I said, "Are you a tourist?" He said, "No." I didn't know what else to say. So I just sat there, looked at him, kindest face I ever saw in my life. He said, "I'm on my way from South Africa to the New Jerusalem." Well, that kind of eliminated any possibilities of it being an earthly being. And then he looked at me again and said, "God bless you. And what you're doing here." You would have had to have been there, folks, and in the same situation I was in to know what a relief that was. He turned and walked back to the main sidewalk through the place, went back towards the gift shop, and as you know, you can't get out of there without passing that area. So at the end of the day, I asked the people in there, I said, "What did you think of that tall, princely-looking man that was dressed in ancient Jewish garb?" And they looked at me real funny, and they said, "Well, Mr. Wyatt, there's nobody like that been in here today." And then they thought for a minute, and they said, "There's never been anybody like that in here." So somewhere between where we were and the entrance, he had disappeared. But what I believe, folks, is what Jacob said about this being the gateway to heaven. I think that's God's place where the angels come to this earth and go out to do their work, come back there and ascend to heaven. And I think that the Son of God is at work on this earth. In fact, he's right here today. Where two or three are gathered, together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. If he wanted to, and if it would help somebody get to heaven that wouldn't otherwise, he could, he would reveal himself today. But he will reveal himself to each of you. When we do meetings, when we do tours, we ask God to send people along that he wants to be there and that will benefit from the experience. He knows who they are, I don't. Then I ask him to help me say exactly what he wants to say. And then I ask him to open the door of salvation to everyone in attendance. I ask that in the name and blood of Jesus. I can guarantee before God today that if you folks just breathe a simple prayer, "Lord, please forgive and cleanse me and help me to be one of your good and faithful servants in Jesus' name and by his blood, he will accept you." I could waste an entire lifetime working with people. I'm sure a lot of you have had opportunities to talk to folks and they kind of dangle the carrot. Well, you know, I'm thinking about it. And you can waste a lot of time working with somebody like that and there's no intent of ever coming over and giving their hearts to the Lord. Satan can get us wasting time with those kinds of people. And we don't spend time with those who will respond. We need to ask God to use us as he did the early disciples. And he can work out everything. He knows who will respond. You folks here will respond. Otherwise, you would not be here. I expect to see everyone again. I don't know what you'll have to go through before you'll be ready for that experience, but God does. And he says he's able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his throne of grace. Right? So the door of salvation is open to you folks. Let's close our eyes, say a little prayer, and then we get to go to lunch. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us. I don't understand why. I doubt that anybody here does. We apologize for all of our pitiful attempts to please you and to be used of you to work for others. We're so thankful for your precious Son and our precious Savior and your promise that you'll send your Holy Spirit to dwell in our hearts, our minds, and that we'll hear a word behind us saying, this is the way, walk in, when we turn to the right hand and when we turn to the left. You know everyone here. You love everyone here. Your Son died for all of us. We ask that you'll please continue to bless these people as only you are wise and powerful and loving enough to do. Give them the joy of working for you in your vineyard and seeing the lost, the hopeless, learn of you and come to you in the name and blood of your Son, that they might find the joy of salvation. We ask that you'll make a quick end to what Satan has done and is doing to your creatures on this earth. We ask that you'll please help us not to contribute to the horrible things he's doing. And we ask that you'll please not let anyone be lost, that you can use us in any way to help them come to you and be saved. In Jesus' name, and by his blood, we pray. And thank you for hearing and granting our request.